Hi all, so welcome to this channel. And in this video session I'll discuss trigger program attributes, trigger limits, adding columns to the tables on which trigger is defined, multiple triggers defined on the same tables. So let's discuss all these points one by one. So first thing is trigger program attribute. So when we create a trigger program, let me show you that. So its type is CLE and program type, it's of program type. So if we do DSP PGM here on this program, so we'll see that the activation group is caller, star caller. So it run in a caller activation group. So that's the main important attribute for the trigger programs. And if we are using any special register in a trigger program, so when before activating the trigger, the register values are saved and they are restored once they are written from the trigger program. So in case if we are using the storage model as single level, and also the program is created with the storage model single level, that's by default with all the RPG ILE programs and even with the trigger program. So in case if the program is let's say not the single level, its storage storage model is, let me show you here. Let's say it's Terra space. So in case it's Terra space, and even if the commitment control is on, then we need to run that particular trigger program in a session where commitment control is on. Commitment control is scope. So we need to run that strcmtctl command with commitment control as start job, scope as commitment scope as start job. In that case, so that's what the case here when we talk about the program attribute. So if we talk about the trigger limits, so there are basically two trigger limits in DB2 for I. First one is the maximum number of triggers which could be applied on a table is 300. That's limited to 300. So that's the max number. We cannot apply trigger more than that. And the second one is if the maximum runtime depth of the cascading trigger is 200. So if the first trigger activated and it then activates the second trigger, and so third trigger, fourth, fifth, and so on, and the maximum cascading depth is 200. So one trigger can activate the second to till third, fourth till five, to fourth activates fifth. So 199th activates 200. So that's the maximum limit. So in case if we exceed that limit, we'll get the limitation that if the trigger won't get activated after that. And the second thing here is the max limit is either 200 runtime depth of the cascading trigger, or the job or job session storage exceeds. So the maximum storage which is allocated for those trigger execution exceeds. So whichever come first, either 200 runtime depth of cascading trigger reaches above the 200, or the storage reaches the maximum for that job or session. So whichever come first. So this is the main two points here, two limitations here for the trigger in DB2 for I. The third one is adding columns to the tables. So let's say we have created columns to tables. Let's say we have created a PF1 and which has, let's say, three fields, field 1, field 2, field 3, and we have applied the trigger on this file pf1. Okay, so when we are adding a new column, let's say I need to add a field 4, new column added. Now the most important thing is the trigger. If we do not recreate the trigger, so what happened? So adding columns to tables, so a table having triggers are defined and we do not recreate those triggers, then what happens at that time? So let's say if there is an update trigger, okay, so I'm talking about the update trigger. So there are two possibilities here for update trigger. Update on every column or on a specific column. So if it's on a specific column, let's say it's on column field 2 or field 3, so what happened? Only when the field 3 gets updated, then only the trigger gets fired or activated. And if it's on every column, there is no specific column or columns are not specified explicitly on update trigger, then what happens if we add a new column to the field 4, to the PF1, let's say field 4, then what happened if the update is happened even on field 4, the trigger gets activated even if we have not recreated the trigger program. So if we have not recreated the trigger program and we have added a new column to the table and we are updating that new column, the trigger would get fired or activated in that case too. But if it is on a specific column, then only when that specific column gets changed, then that trigger gets activated, otherwise it won't. Now the another situation here is, this was the first point. And the second point would be, let's say if there is any SQL statement we are using in our trigger program, then if we do not trigger program once we added a new column to the table, then we are not able to access that new column value in the SQL statement. So basically we need to recreate our trigger program when we are adding a new column to the table on which the trigger is defined. So basically we need to recreate all those triggers which are defined on the table. So this was one thing which is very important, so if which we must know. This was the first thing. If it's update trigger, then there are two possibilities which I discussed, and the second thing is if we are using the SQL statement, then we are not able to access the new column values if we do not recreate the trigger program. And the third point is that if we are using the transition table concept, so if we are using the transition table concept, so we have old table and new table both available. So in that old and new table, what we have basically, we have all the columns values, so even field 1, field 2, field 3 and also field 4, even if we do not have recreated the trigger programs defined on that table after adding this new transition. So in transition table we have all the fields, field 2, field 3, field 2, field 3 and field 4, but we would not be able to use that value that is added newly to the table. So we are not able to use the field value which is added newly to the table, so we need to recreate the trigger in this case too. So if we are using the transition table concept, we must be recreating the trigger program which is defined on that table on which we are going to add that new field. basically just because if we are having any SQL statements and referring to all the columns, then we are not able to get or access the value of the new column which we have just defined on the table on which that trigger program is created. So we need to recreate the program. So here we need to recreate the program, here also we need to recreate the program, and in this case too we need to recreate the program. But if it's an update trigger and it's on every column, there is no such a specific column specified explicitly, then the update on that new column which is added to the table would fire, activate that trigger even if we do not recreate the trigger. So that's all the most important things which we must know while we are adding a new column to a table on which the trigger is defined. And the next and the last thing is multiple triggers on the same table. So in this case I'm just going to discuss the most important thing is multiple triggers on same table. So this was adding columns to the tables. So yes, of course, sure, we can add multiple triggers on the same table. So let's take this example where we have PF1 and field 1, field 2 and field 3. So let's say I am going to add let's say 10 trigger, 10 before update trigger on this table, and on specific field 3, when this field 3 gets updated, then those trigger gets fired. Or I can define one trigger on field 1, second trigger on field 2, and third trigger on field 3. So let's say I'm defining 3 triggers on every field. So if this field gets updated, then trigger 1 fired. If this trigger 2 fired, trigger 2 fired. If this trigger gets updated, trigger 3 fired on the update before mode, before time. Okay. So also what we can do, we can apply the multiple triggers on same field, field 1. So let's say field 1 gets updated, we can fire trigger 1, trigger 2, trigger 3, trigger 4. Let's say we can fire triggers, we can fire up to its maximum limit. So of course, sure, we can add multiple triggers on the same table. So what happens in that case, now when we create the triggers, then the numbering matters there. So in which numbering, let's say I created trigger 1 first, then trigger 2 second, then trigger 3 third, and trigger 1 executed first, then 2 secondly, and third at third time. So the numbering matters. So and in case if we have replaced that trigger using create or replace command, then that numbering won't exist anymore, not maintained anymore, you can say. So there is one more thing which is very important here, is the mode. Since we all know that we use the mode db2 row and mode db2 sql. So if the mode is db2 row, then it is activated for each row, and if it's mode db2 sql, then it's activated at the last when all the rows either insert, update or deleted for that particular sql statement. So let me tell you, if there are, let's say, 5 triggers which are defined on the db2 row, then they are executed first with the numbered with the priority which at which they created. Let's say the trigger 1, trigger 2, trigger 3, 4 and 5, they are created like first trigger 1 gets created, then trigger 2 and till trigger 5 gets created. So if they are defined on mode db2 row, they will be gets the priority first with trigger 1 first, trigger 2 second, trigger 3, 4 and 5 as the way they created. After that, if trigger 6, 7, 8 or 9 or 10 are there, even if they created first before the trigger 1 or 5, they will be called next after all DB2 rogues activated, just because they will be it's their nature, you can say, because they are fired once the statement gets complete or all the rows gets updated. So it depends whether we are using for each row or for each statement. So for each statement, if we are using for each statement, then the more DB2 SQL is there, we cannot apply more DB2 row. If the for each row there, then we can have more DB2 row and more DB2 SQL. So in that case, if for each row, then that means if you are using more DB2 SQL, even in that, once that all those rows gets updated, after that the trigger gets fired n number of times, where n is the number of rows which gets changed or updated. So this way we can have multiple triggers on the same tables, even with the same mode and same time or same event. So that's all in this video or in this session, which I have covered. So I think this video will give you enough information about the trigger, basically the additional information about the triggers. So I think that's all in this video. Thank you and have